On December the 19th, 1875, Carter Godwood Woodson was born to former slaves James Henry and Anne Woodson in New Canton, Virginia. During this time, it was the end of Reconstruction with the Compromise of 1877. It was also the time when George Washington Williams' History of the Negro Race in America from 1619 to 1880 was published, which was in 1882. After leaving Buckingham County, West Virginia, W.E.B. Du Bois became the first African American to earn his Ph.D. in history at Harvard in 1895. In 1903, Woodson graduates from Berea College and travels to the Philippines for the U.S. War Department. He then begins his travels to the continent of Africa, then later Asia, and he ended in Europe attending the Sorbonne in Paris, France, while attending the University of Chicago as a full-time graduate student. He was also a member of the Omega Psi Phi and the first black professional fraternity, Sigma Pi Phi. He then receives his master's degree in history, Romance Languages and Literature from the University of Chicago in 1908. After leaving Chicago, he attends Harvard University as a PhD candidate in history, studying American and European history from 1908 to 1909. In 1915, he publishes The Education of the Negro prior to 1861, a history of the education of the colored people of the United States from the beginning of slavery to the Civil War. That same year in 1915, he and George Cleveland Hall, James E. Stamps, and Alexander L. Jackson co-found the Association for the Study of Negro Life and History, the ASNLH. In 1916, the first issue of the Journal of Negro History launches. Fast forward, in 1919 to 1920, he serves as a Dean of School of Liberal Arts at Howard University in Washington, D.C. He introduces the study of black history and graduate studies in history at Howard. At this time during Howard, in 1920, he joins the Friends of Negro Freedom, serves as a dean of West Virginia Collegiate Institute. He later employs J.E. Orms as a field agent to help increase the ASNLH membership, sell books and subscriptions to the Journal of Negro History, and organize Negro History Clubs. 1921, Dr. Woodson found the Association Publishers, Inc. He receives a grant from the Carnegie Institution and writes The Case of the Negro. In 1922, Laura Spelman Rockefeller Foundation awards Dr. Woodson $25,000. July 18th, Dr. Woodson purchases the three-story Victorian-style brick row house at 1538 Knight Street, Northwest, Washington, D.C.
Woodson would decommission, as well as all the other fireplaces in the house when he moves in 1923. When we got here, this fireplace looked like that. The top image was falling apart because Dr. Woodson didn't really care about the maintenance of his own home. To him, this was a vessel that was to help the work spread, so he didn't really care if, you know, things were falling apart around here. So we used the original bricks to reconstruct it to what it would have been like, say, in the 1923 when he moved in. And then we plastered over it the same way that he would have plastered over it. All right, so we can continue down this hallway.
And you said this is his distribution room right here.
So this is the distribution room, and the other one was the book room.
Yeah, so that's book storage, and shipping and packaging.
And shipping and package. Mm-hmm. And of course, he sat up front up here at the typewriter and made sure everything was given out appropriately. Things were being done appropriately.
So this is where the secretary,
Nice. And of course, he said eventually you guys are going to get your stuff, all his original property in eventually?
Well, not his original property, not all of it. House will not serve the way that most historic houses are.
Okay.
So we're looking more towards audiovisual presentations and visual exhibits.
Yeah.
So we'll have some period pieces to represent Dr. Woodson's things. We won't have his original furniture in the house, but this house will mostly be dealing with a different kind of experience.
Gotcha.
So we're going to head on up these stairs.
Okay, okay.
So you're walking literally in the footsteps of Dr. Woodson himself, as well as some of his most notable employees, including Zora Neale Hurston, Langston Hughes, and Lorenzo Johnson Green. Excuse me. So this is the kitchen, or the break room. Dr. Woodson doesn't really have a purpose for a kitchen because he takes all of his meals at the YWCA right here on the corner here. So what he will actually do is give this space for his staff to have like a break room, a place to relax. And at 12:15, he gathers them all together, or they gather themselves, and then he gives them their daily tasks. Now, when Dr. Woodson is giving them tasks, it's them with the air of someone who, wouldn't do that themselves. So Dr. Woodson would, for instance, scrub the floors on his hands and knees on his own. He would take the slow, minor, this is a part of the tour.
No, don't worry.
So instance, Dr. Woodson poured every little last bit of himself into his organization, including his paycheck. Mm-hmm. He was the lowest paid member of his staff. He took a salary about $12 to $15 a week to survive off of. The rest is getting put directly back into his organization. So he took a vow of poverty to make sure that his organization could thrive. So when things are breaking down around the house, so because he couldn't afford or he didn't want to spend the money on someone to come and fix it for him, he would say if the doorknob was falling apart, he would go to the hardware store, find the cheapest option available, come home, fix it himself. So that's why now the doorknobs in the house actually match. Alright, so we're going to head on down this hallway to Dr. Woodson's home office, or his office home as he affectionately called it. Alrighty. So he would have had a massive desk here with papers piled high, books open all over the place. One person once lamented they had never seen an editor with a messier desk. If you look here, you can see a representation of that. He's got a couple of different copies of the Negro History Bulletin. Some loose leaf papers hanging about. So that's just showing what his desk would have looked like on the regular. Now, if you look through this window here, you can see the historic Shaw neighborhood, which is the neighborhood that Dr. Woodson would have known when he was here. Because it's historic, developers, when they come into the area, they aren't allowed to touch these facades. So that way we know for a fact that this is what the neighborhood looked like in 1923 when Dr. Woodson was here. I'm sorry, between 1923 and 1950. Now, Dr. Woodson was also a very active member of his community. He wasn't just the guy that sat up on the second floor of his house and just watched life go by as he wrote all day. He was hand-delivering his materials to the post office. He was walking to the neighborhood schools to deliver talks. He was regaling the neighborhood kids with tales of Egyptian pharaohs, West African kings and queens. He was an active member of his community. He even got a nickname from the neighborhood kids because he walked so much with his arms full of books, they started calling him Bookman. So he wanted to be sure that those students knew that their history didn't just start with slavery, that it was a very noble time for their people, and it's something that they overcame. But he wanted them to know that it didn't just start there. They had a rich history that started way before capture and enslavement. So when we came to the house, house. We wanted to make sure that we kept with that trend of historic, of the historic neighborhood. So if you see, I'm sorry,
This
top picture here is what the house looked like in the 1970s, right before Asala will actually leave this house and go to a separate location on this time 14th Street. Now here, this is a picture taken in 2006, and you can see that the actual brick of the home has been removed. So what we did was we took each individual brick, removed them, numbered them one by one, and then put them back in the right place. So if you go out and brace yourself against the wall, if Dr. Woodson had braced himself against the wall, you'd be touching a spot that he touched. All right. So we can continue down the hallway into this room here. Right, so this is what I would say is the most important room in the house because it's the library. And this is where the researchers would spend the majority of their time working. So this is one of Dr. Woodson's most notable photographs. It's one of the few...
So it's this room.
I'm sorry?
So that photograph...
Yeah, it's taken in this room. It's actually against this very wall. So you can actually see through the doorway. You can see his desk and all of those books. You can look through the window and see that historic structure that we were just looking at. And of course, you got Dr. Woodson and his bookcase. So each of these walls would have had their own massive bookcase piled high with books.
Family, did you just hear what this young lady said? This beautiful tourist has just explained, employee of the National Park Service has explained to me that all of the pictures that we post on Facebook, all of the pictures that that's floating around on either social media or just on the website is this room right here. All of the bookshelves are here. That's what she just finished telling you. This is absolutely beautiful.
All right, so we can head on up the steps. And so this is what I would say is the most private area of the house. So this is Dr. Woodson's private residence. So not a lot of people were allowed up these steps, as this is not where the Asala is functioning out of. This is just where he sleeps, where he gets his privacy. So we can start to head on up.
Okay.
Now that room directly ahead of you is more book storage, which just speaks towards Dr. Woodson's character and his sort of drive. So Dr. Woodson only has three rooms up here, as you can see, and he still takes one of them and reserves it for his organization, for his books. Now this is the living room or the sitting room. We know two people that were allowed in this space, Nanny Helen Burroughs and Mary McLeod Bethune, two women that were very close with Dr. Woodson, the only individuals that were allowed to call him Carter, his first name, and they were constantly trying to set him up on dates. Because he takes a vow of celibacy as well as a vow of poverty. Excuse me. Because he used to say that women spend on cigarettes and drink in one day on what he brought in a week. Now, he doesn't mean that to be disparaging towards women. Excuse me. But he means it to say that these are luxuries of life. And he recognizes that. And he wouldn't ask anyone, especially a woman, to sort of reject those luxuries to be with him. It was a burden he wouldn't ask other people to do on his behalf. All right, so we can head on into this room here. Now this is the most private room in the house. Two people for certain were allowed in this space. Dr. Woodson himself and a man known as Robert Best. Now Robert Best was 15 years old when he came to work for Dr. Woodson, and he was his mail boy. His one job, his one opportunity to come in the house, it was with a key. That Dr. Carter G. Woodson would leave him when he went out of town. He would use it on this door here, take Dr. Woodson's mail, leave it on the nightstand, and then immediately leave. He was not allowed to stay in this room. In fact, if Dr. Woodson would found one black hair on his bedspread, he was firing anyone who had access to the space. How do we know? Because Robert Best told us that that's how he got his job. So,
wow.
The prior mayor boy had actually left of one black hair. Dr. Woodson kind of told the guy off and fired him and hired Robert.
Right. Incredible.
But this would have been Dr. Woodson's private sanctum, the one place that he probably didn't have to be Dr. Woodson. He was just Carter, the son of escaped slaves. He was the former garbage collector, the former coal miner. He was the principal of a school, a teacher by trade, not necessarily the father of Black history and everything that goes with that. Mm. And in this room, he could just probably relax and be himself. Now on his last day, April 3rd, 1950, his secretary heard him walking across his floor and assumed he was all right, but he didn't come down to address his staff at 12:15. She became worried and came up the steps to knock very timidly on the door. Now when she didn't get a response, she became even more worried. She goes back down the steps and she gets one of the Woodson boys, who are a group of mentees of Dr. Woodson, to come upstairs and knock the door down. That's when they find that Dr. Woodson has actually passed away in his bed from a heart attack. He might have even been a broken heart, because 2 days prior, on April 1st, 1950, his dear friend Charles Drew died of a very tragic, very sudden car accident. So they say he was 74, he was in a state of mourning, his heart probably just couldn't take it. But this would have been the way that Dr. Woodson probably would have wanted to go. There's no fanfare. There were no family members waiting around his bed, just waiting for the moment that he moved on to the other side. The newspapers didn't get wind of it and plastered every headline with father of Black history preparing to die. This way he was able to just close his eyes, lay down, and just go.